Welcome to the Masterminding Show, and today we have none other than former NFL football player, entrepreneur, and author, Mr. Dennis Franks. Hey everybody, welcome to the Masterminding Podcast with Grind Life. This is Don Martin, your host, and today, it's one of the few times actually that I've been a little nervous about the broadcast because Dennis is one of the few guys that can kind of call me out. He's watched me grow up in business, so he probably knows my story, you know, more than anybody else. But at the same time, I'm super excited because I don't know if you realize this or not, but I just wanted to first say to you that you've been one of the most instrumental mentors to me from afar and also getting closer through the years. And I just wanted you to know how much I appreciate that.
Thanks, Don. It's great to be with you today. It's always a pleasure to be with up-and-comers and people like yourself. High energy, that's what it's all about. Delivering, you're doing what great things for the community.
I appreciate that. And so I'm excited about this. There's a lot that people that are listening are going to love today. But I just want to introduce everybody to this gentleman to my right. His name is Mr. Dennis Franks. And just he is, first and foremost, he's a retired NFL professional football player. And he's also turned entrepreneur since then, but he's actually evolved in that world to become a top-notch executive, one of the best that I've ever seen, and also now an author, a speaker, a trainer, and it's just a pleasure to have you, man. I appreciate your time.
Again, anytime I can get together with people I like, wonderful, and send out a message or two, it's even better.
Yeah, I agree. So let's just roll right into kind of your backstory. If you can tell everybody a little bit about you,
sure.
Where you were born and raised, and kind of how you started to come into the world of, I guess, sports and fitness to start.
You bet, Don. You know, I am a son of a steel worker. I'm from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, actually a small town on the river called Clairton, Pennsylvania. And back in the day when I grew up, Western Pennsylvania was a hotbed for athletes. The Joe Namaths of the world, the Mike Ditkas, you might know the name Joe Montana. Okay. You know, a lot of people coming from that area. And it was fun. And I think one of the reasons was our background. We came back in blue-collar families. We had to work hard. It was almost like building our futures to escape the environment of the steel mills. I know my brother Don and my sister Claudia, I was the youngest of three, but our family really focused on putting one person into school, and that was my older brother. He was going to go to college, and he was going to be the superhero of the family, you know, kind of thing. But I really appreciated the values growing up. There's so many good things that I've learned, and I carry on forward today with family. And it's really all about hard work, you know, getting out there, putting your talents to work for you. And my father was a big inspiration to that. But I got to tell you, most people don't know, my mom, she was a professional ice skater. In fact, she was a national champion figure skater of Germany. Dad was Italian, mom was German, and my brother and I grew up in figure skating.
No kidding.
Ice rinks, you know, all over the place, and we took athletes or the students that my mom taught through ice dancing. You know, if you ever seen them on the Olympics, I started off my athletic career as an ice dancer.
It's so funny that you bring that up. I just heard that earlier today, actually. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
And I just want to tell you that I had no clue, you know, from an athletic perspective that you had that, because I grew up in dance studios.
Oh, wow.
My mom was a dance teacher. So literally, I didn't have a choice but to dance from the age of 2 until 12. Until I was old enough to want to play baseball more, because that's where I kind of,
you know, it's a shame our moms basically put us through that.
Right.
We didn't even know we were going to dance and I was going to skate.
But you know what? I think maybe they gave us this hidden edge that we didn't know we were going to have when it came to
Who would know? You know, a lot of the ball players today take ballet.
Yes, they do.
I mean, to get more flexibility, more balance, and precision and discipline.
Another thing I heard you said just when you got to the NFL, which we'll talk about here in a few, but you said some of the things that you did training-wise for balance was kung fu.
Right.
I died when I heard that. So.
Well, you know, martial arts is amazing. Mm-hmm. It's discipline. You learn how to leverage a person's energy and their forces to your advantages. Also, it teaches you how to be more disciplined in not being the attacker. Don't initiate the problem, but primarily, you know, be ready for any challenge that comes up.
I guess a lot of lessons in business that way too.
Life is all about that.
For sure.
Choices and disciplines.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful. So when you were growing up, so what was your first big dream? Like, what did you want to be? The farthest that you could think back, was it a football player or was there something before that? What was it? Like, first thing.
First thing?
Yeah,
first I wanted to be a cowboy.
Okay, I love that. That's good.
my dad brought my brother and I up as actually a carpenters or bricklayers because he was old school. And
he was my dad.
It was all about taking care of the family. Mm-hmm. He would grow up and eventually have to work and take care of your family, and so he wanted to prepare us for that. But ultimately, I remember running around with my cowboy hat on, and I had my guns, my six shooters on both sides running around.
That's the best. Know.
But I guess the real dream started to evolve based on living in an alley in a bunch of row homes where four row homes down, there was a gentleman by the name of Jimmy Kelly. And Jimmy Kelly played at Clarendon High School, and he was a tight end. He was good.
Football player.
Mm-hmm. And Jimmy was several years older than me, but all of a sudden, he got a scholarship to Notre Dame to play football. And everybody in town was talking about Jimmy Kelly.
Yeah.
That was my first thing. Is this, Mom, Dad, I want to be like Jimmy Kelly.
There you go. a local kid, a neighbor?
Yeah.
That's great.
In fact, a lot of our dreams or aspirations come from the people around us that we're basically exposed to. And it just makes sense to us in a wonderful direction until something else happens.
Right. You know? And it's funny because you actually mentioned something in your book about Jimmy Kelly, which I love, which I'll talk about later. But like when you saw him make that, what was the driver for you? Was it the escape from the neighborhood, or was it the notoriety that comes with it?
That's a really good point, because Dad worked in the steel mill 45 years before he got his watch and retired. And you got to understand, whenever you work with one company for that long, you get to know a lot of the locals. And I will say this, you know, I was brought up in an environment, if you saw a nice car, my father would have responded, says, you know, that guy must be in the mafia to afford that kind of car.
We have such a similar background. It's crazy.
But you know what? He didn't know anything better.
Right,
he knew how to go to work, pick up some side jobs, do what he had to do to take care of the family and keep things going.
Yeah, that's amazing. Gee, I don't know if you're aware of this, but my grandmother was born, and my grandmother and grandfather were born in Pittsburgh.
I didn't know that at all. Munhall's down the road.
Right by the riverside.
I have partners down Munhall still to this day.
Absolutely. And my cousins still live there. But the reason why my grandmother and grandfather ended up out here was because my grandfather was with the steel mill, and they moved him out here to open the Fairless Steel Center. And I grew up in Fairless Hills, Pennsylvania.
Okay.
My dad's first job was at the steel mill too, which is crazy. So a lot of cool similarities. So you went to college.
Yep.
Scholarship?
Yeah, I was very fortunate. This is a funny story. I was going to go to Clarendon High School, but when I was in the seventh grade, my father hit the numbers. Now, if you don't know what the numbers are, every time you went into the mill, you take a dollar out and basically play your four or five favorite numbers.
Okay.
Well, he played his four or five favorite numbers, and he hit one day.
No way.
And the next thing I knew, we sold the row home, and we lived in Bethel Park, Pennsylvania, in a real house.
I didn't know that. That's crazy.
Three bedrooms, bath and a half. Man, it was huge.
Yeah, compared to what you get.
Yeah.
Well,
I mean,
that's awesome.
And so I ended up going to Bethel Park High School. I transitioned from ice skating into football.
Smooth transition.
By the way, how did you transition out of dance into baseball?
I was baseball since my dad had the influence over that. So it was kind of a competitive influence for sure. It was like mom with the dance, dad with the baseball, ultimately.
Well, I was embarrassed. I hated to be with the guys and say, I skate. And they'd say, what?
Same thing. Same thing until they saw the pictures of me with all the girls.
Right.
That
there
was the
you
only
go.
Leverage I had. You know? So,
but anyway.
Me and eight girls.
Anyway, those were some great days. We had a football coach by the name of Rudy Andabaker. And mm-hmm. Rudy was played for the Pittsburgh Steelers. And Richard Mongoluso was his right-hand man. Mongo was his name. Big boy from Denora. Both of them were from Denora. And we were out in the South Hills. And so they brought some toughness out. But Rudy was the first disciplinarian that I met. And he knew how to take care of discipline. He had something called the Whistler. And the Whistler was this big old paddle with holes in it.
I get it.
And when you didn't do your job, you'd go in the locker room, all the guys would be around you, you'd bend over and he'd smack you in the rear end. And Lord, you'd like to see God at that time.
Mm-hmm. And stuff that wouldn't quite go today, right?
No, I mean, no. They'd be sued by 100 different parents.
100 different people.
I played multiple sports, but I got into track, shot put, discus. Mm-hmm. I excelled at discus.
You were an All-American or second team All-American or something like that.
High school.
Yeah.
As a middle linebacker and offensive guard, both ways.
Really? No
I played both ways. Yeah. And then I ended up going to the state championship and throwing the discus and bringing home a trophy. I thought that was pretty cool too.
Heck
but
yeah, man.
Coupled with football, with track, I had 113 scholarships. Which is unheard of. In fact, I want to tell you
I thought I was cool with four. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, I had four.
But people have a hard time believing me when I said, Bear Bryant was at my house. Woody Hayes was at my house. Joe Paterno was at my house. Mm-hmm. Bobby Bowden was at my house. John McKay was at my house. I didn't know who they were.
Yeah.
I walked the campus of Notre Dame with Eric Persijan. And him telling me about the tradition of the Golden Dome, touchdown Jesus, and how if I would go to Notre Dame, it would change my life. But only one coach, though. One coach told me like it was.
Yeah.
And that was Bo Schembechler at the University of Michigan. And he was the only one. Don, he sat me down. He says, so you're Dennis Franks. He goes, I hear you're pretty good. And you know what he said to me? He says, I don't know if you're good enough to play in Michigan.
Wow.
The only coach that said that. But he said, I'd give you a shot if you want to come, And so we talked, and I chose Michigan.
That's amazing.
If I had to do it again, I'd probably choose it. But at the same time, I think about Southern Cal. I think about Alabama. I think about Florida State. I think about those other colleges and how would it be different.
But at the same time, I think it worked out pretty good for you.
Absolutely.
It was a cool thing. So you went to Michigan. Mm-hmm. You excelled.
Well, yeah, I ended up. I went as a middle linebacker, and I was crushed.
I love this story. By
the way, this was probably one of the biggest setbacks of my life.
Yeah.
I came in middle linebacker. Steve Stranko was the other inside
prestigious
linebacker
position.
Yeah, man, line up, just tear it up. The ball goes. You go.
Yeah.
And we played a five-man front, so you had two. You had a strong side and a weak side linebacker. So Steve and I were all planning to go in there together.
Yeah.
Then all of a sudden, going into my sophomore year, Bo grabs me and says, I need you. What do you need, coach? Whatever. He says, I need you to play center.
Yeah.
Center? I never played center in my life. You mean where I got to snap the ball, have somebody's hands on my ass, and then block somebody when my hands are between my legs and make something happen? I was devastated.
Yeah.
I was ready to pack it up. So Terrell Burton, a great guy, wide receiver coach, and Rocco Hanlon, he was about 5'7".
Yeah.
Rocco said, hey, try it. Don't get so upset. So Michigan has a large roster of talented people. So going into spring ball my sophomore year, oh, by the way, you got some good guys.
I'm getting there, man. I'm trying to take after you. I'm going to grow up to be like you, man.
So,
by the way, your picture that you had on social media about, it was probably 6 months ago, and you were in Miami, your shirt was off, you had the six pack and a beer in your hand. I'm like, I'm going to be like that when I grow up, man. That was it. I'm like, I told Lisa, that's going to be me at 65.
So that's a good time. It's important to have fun. If
you have to
win.
Have fun. That's right.
But, I start thinking about all that going on. And so I was fifth team center going into spring ball, which is before the season starts. And I worked my way up with thousands of repetitions to second team. And I went into my sophomore year as a second team center, got to play. Leonard, great. And then I came back my junior year and was able to start. And my senior year, second team All-American. I was on the team of the decade. No other team won more games than Michigan in the 70s.
There you go. You know, and you were there. You were a piece of that.
I was a piece of that. Yeah, it was a great time.
Super cool.
I studied, too.
A little bit. Comes with the territory.
I studied economics.
And did you do well in school, by the way? Just out of curiosity.
You know what? I did well enough.
To be able to play.
I was a C person.
Me too.
And maybe like a B minus on occasion.
I love it, man. We have so much. You know, it's funny that you, with your background, too, where you said you went to as a linebacker and then you
got moved.
Became center.
Yeah, right.
I was recruited full scholarship for baseball as a first baseman.
Oh.
And we had a bad pitching core that first year, and I could pitch. And I told the coach, I'm like, I was competitive. I was to the core competitive. I'm like, just let me. We got annihilated the first game of the season. I'm like, just let me pitch. We were playing Hofstra. I mean, just let me pitch. He's like, just let me pitch. You saw me pitch. You recruited me. You knew I pitched and played first.
Right.
And we beat him 8-3. Boom, never played first base again, which devastated me because I'm only 6 foot even. Pitchers typically should be a little taller.
A little more leverage.
But, I was competitive, so I was able to do well. But I kind of wish that I
– You bring up something that I wish more athletes today would do. Remember, we played multiple sports, multiple positions
Absolutely.
All the time.
Yeah.
Today, everybody's got to be a focused
– Or specialist.
One sport specialist kind of thing, you know. How do you really know what you want to do at 7 or 8 or 9?
Yeah, yeah. A lot of times the parents think.
Yeah.
And a lot of times parents, and I think this is also true in people's lives, and I think this is a good point for people. A lot of times the parents try to live through their kids.
Yep.
And they get their kids to do something that they weren't able to do, and they try to live through their kids instead of letting them figure it out for themselves. And a lot of times, like, you know, they just go with the flow because they're making their parents happy.
Right.
But it's maybe not really fulfilling for them.
Right. Do you want to hear something amazing? Coach Saban down in Alabama actually offered a scholarship to an 8th grader.
Really?
They're offering scholarships younger and younger because it's so competitive out there.
Right.
I loved what Coach Harbaugh did in Michigan. He went down and set up summer camps in Alabama. Wherever the great athletes were, he'd bring Michigan down, set up camps.
Yeah.
I mean, it's heavy. College ball today is about recruiting.
Well, because it's a big money sport. It's because it's big money, and so that's a big deal. So you very competitive team of the decade. You knew you were going to go play pro ball.
They told me they were going to draft me.
Yeah. So what happened? Draft comes. Same thing happened to me my junior year. What happens to you?
Well, what happens my senior year? I was quick and I was strong, but I was only 6 foot and 1 3/4 inch. I was right under 6'2".
Mm-hmm.
I finished college at 248 pounds, small as an offensive center in the NFL. But
248,
mm-hmm. and they had me at 6'2", but I was just a shade under.
Yeah.
You know how you stretch for that, like
that
you should have been 6'5", 6'1".
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But all you short people know what I'm saying.
That's right.
But
I am actually 5'11½".
Okay,
but I say 6 foot.
Okay, well that's fair.
That's
you know,
right.
Like if you had a little more hair, you'd be 6. No problem.
No problem.
Maybe
that left me long ago.
But anyway, I was thinking about that, and I was just saying, I can't wait. So it was 2 days of draft. I sat in the apartment. I had the keg going. I had my buddies over. We're all together.
Ready to go.
Looking at that phone.
Waiting for it.
Looking at that phone. 2 days, that phone didn't ring.
Mm-hmm.
Draft was over. Mad.
Yeah.
Phone started ringing.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, everybody wanted me as a free agent.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't good enough to take a pick.
Right.
But I was good enough to be invited, you know, and... after all, my agent said to me, maybe it's better. Because usually if you don't go in the first 3 or 4 rounds, it's better to be able to examine where you have the best shot to take a position.
Okay.
And that really came down to Minnesota or Philadelphia. Their backup centers, you look at their backups and you see where you can crack the lineup.
Sure, okay.
And so I chose between Minnesota and Philadelphia, and I went to Philadelphia.
Okay. So you actually were signed with the Eagles originally?
Right, that's where I went. And that was 1975, if you know your mathematics. That's when football was still football.
Yeah, not as many of them rules.
Right, and no free agency. We still broke wedges. coaches, you know, and we still had to have the discipline.
Awesome story about that.
Oh, too, yeah. You know. Well, my job, a lot of people don't know, my job was to take down two or more men in a wedge so that my partner, Vince Papale, can go there and make the tackle. But, you know, everybody has their job to do.
Yeah.
You know, on
yeah.
any team, just do your job and the outcome will be right, you know.
So you get picked, the Eagles, you start playing, and then something really kind of a cool thing happens. Was it your first year?
Mm-hmm.
You guys were 4-12.
Yep.
Correct?
Yeah, that's
and,
right.
And
1975.
And, right,
Mike
and,
McCormick and Roman Gabriel was the quarterback.
There you go. So then Coach Vermeil
mm-hmm.
does something. And this is how you and Vince gets connected. So tell everybody that story, Vince Papale, which by the way, we can talk about. But,
right.
but the movie Invincible
that's
was
correct.
A true story about Vince, and
Maggie,
you were a
right,
big piece of that.
Right, and he always says, yeah, Denny was featured in the movie.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
You might know him as the White Knuckles guy.
That's right, that you was know. You, the White Knuckles guy. Look at my knuckles.
Yeah. So 76 comes in, and Coach Vermeil comes in, from UCLA, young guy, all the old guys saying, oh, this college coach, get him out of here.
Right.
He's going to come in and rah-rahs. Well, the first thing he says, he brings the team together. And he says, nobody got a job here. Nobody got a job. Don't ever think you're going to be a starter here. Now you're going to earn it. And you know what? Just to prove it, I'm going to have open tryouts.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not only going to draft, I'm going to have open tryouts. Anybody who wants to come and prove this team, that's what I'm going to do.
Awesome.
You know, and believe it or not, before that happened in the off season, I'm going to tell you this. Now listen carefully for this, because I didn't retire with a lot of money. My rookie season, I signed for $18,500 with a $4,000 bonus.
You were rolling.
Well, back then, that was good. And like 2,000 of that I partied with when I signed.
Yeah, you know,
it was gone. It was gone.
Talk your buddies out, right?
But, you know, you look at those days and how everything changed. But I was a bouncer in the offseason. I call it floor control engineer.
There it is. I like that. That's a lot better name.
That's classic. Engineers are respected.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't want to be the enforcer. So I was a bouncer at a place called Franny O'Brien's. Great place on the main line.
Mm-hmm.
The place to be.
Still?
Yeah.
Okay.
And there was this guy there, good looking guy. Vince Papale was his name. And he was talking about how he was going to go out for the Eagles and make the Eagles. I look at him and I said, where'd you play? He said, I didn't. I said, where'd you go to school?
So you actually met him before?
Yeah, at the bar.
He went, kidding.
He got a job at the door.
Okay.
He got a job at the door.
That's awesome. I had no idea.
Yeah, so that's where I first met Vinny right there. Well, actually, I first met Vinny at Penn State when I was throwing for the state discus championship. That and you know how ironic it was. Vince was coaching another high school, and there was a wide receiver by the name of Scott Fitzke.
Mm-hmm.
He was running sprints. He ran a 9.7 500 meter and won state champion.
Wow.
Scott ended up playing on the team with us down the road too.
That's crazy.
I mean,
I had no idea about that.
Small
That's really
world.
Cool. Yeah.
But it was good. It was a great experience. I said, you're too pretty to play. He says, ha. You know, but we got to be good friends after one night. We had a brawl. There was a fight. We had a fight back to back. And we got our asses kicked, frankly. There was too many of them, but, you know, we did all right. We got them out the door. But we looked at each other. We started laughing.
That's
we just
amazing.
Started laughing. We're the best of friends ever since.
That's crazy.
40 years
and
now.
You guys still friends.
Yeah.
That's pretty awesome. And that leads to this. So, and I'm going to get into what you and Vince have done together since.
Right.
I think it's really cool. But tell us about this. You're a five-year career in the NFL.
Yeah.
And give us the biggest highlight of your career, by the way. Was there one time that sticks out over all others? I'm sure it was awesome just being at that level for sure. But was there one time that really kind of stuck out above all other in moments in your career?
Well, there were a couple. I'm going to mention two highlights. One was the Miracle of the Meadowlands. In 1978, the Philadelphia Eagles hadn't been to the playoffs since 1960.
Wow.
And Joe Pisarcik was the quarterback. Larry Zonka was the running back of the Giants. And all the Giants had to do to win was to put a knee down. There was only like 20 seconds left.
Yeah.
But they decided that they were going to snap the ball and hand it off. And the exchange, there was a fumble. And Herman Edwards, who now coaches at Arizona State, great ball player, defensive back for the Eagles, I called him West Bay. He picked that ball up and ran 60 yards. Scored,
mm-hmm.
and I mean, there was an eruption.
Right,
I mean, just an eruption, man. We just like celebrated so much. It was great.
Did that get you in the playoffs?
Yeah, that got us in the playoffs. We went down to Atlanta. We did a good job against them. But that started that whole movement to the 80 championship where we went to Super Bowl 15.
Yeah, against
the Raiders. Was really good. Yeah, absolutely.
Yep, awesome.
So that was good. The other thing that I want to bring up was in 1976, I was snapping the ball, and we were snapping from our own 3-yard line. And I didn't have a bad snap throughout my college career.
It's kind of like almost like, oh, you're doomed, right?
Right. So across from me, there's a couple defensive linemen talking about my mother and the night out they had with her, and I'm getting a little bit edgy.
A little edgy, right?
Sure. So I start thinking about how I was going to take one out, and then I snapped the ball, and I snapped it right over Spike Jones' head for safety. Now, it was a tough one because it was only a 3-point difference, and so now they were within 1 point. Mm-hmm. We had to kick from the 20. I was booed by 78,000 people.
So when people in business, that's a great thing to say. When people in business have one person question them, that's nothing.
Yeah, until you've been booed by 78,000 people.
You don't know rejection.
That's right. You really don't know rejection.
That's great.
And I'll never forget Dick Vermeil. He looked at me on the sideline. He said, "Franks, don't ever do that again. Or you'll be looking for a job." You know,
that was it.
That's it. Yes, sir.
Yes, that's it.
That was good.
Hey, that's all you needed at that point.
Yeah.
You knew.
Hey,
78,000 people already told you.
Yeah,
you
right,
know what I mean?
Right, yeah.
Oh, my goodness. So from there, you retired from football.
Yep.
You end up.
I went to Detroit.
You went to the Lions, correct?
I went to the Lions, finished my career there. And it was ironic. I could have played the third game of the season going into my sixth year. I just was done. I didn't love the game anymore.
Amazing.
And I went in and talked to Monty Clark. I said, he was the head coach. I said, "Monty, I just don't love the game anymore." And I said, "I'm going home. I'm going to go and wish you the best of luck. Thank you for the opportunity."
Yeah.
In fact, Detroit was wonderful for me. I was captain of their special teams. They gave me a football card, which is, in football, you get a Topps bubblegum card.
Yeah.
You're like, whoa, man.
That's a cool card, by the way.
Thank you.
It's
worth like 25 cents.
There you go. Just crank it up in the back.
But they could never take it away from me.
That's right. That's the key. So tell us about that transition. So you decided to leave football, right?
Yeah, I decided.
So this kind of gets into the entrepreneur world, the executive world, the author and the speaker world. And I think that's what awesome story and background.
There's
so much to learn from that. But now you're in the point now where you had this transition. You finished football. You were used to, now you were starting to make some money.
Right.
So
I left football, and I wanted to depend on my education.
Okay.
No, my education.
Because
you got to be older to get a pension.
Sure.
I was the ripe old age of 29.
I get it.
Come on now. So
you knew you had a pension.
Right. Which is nice. Which is now kicked in.
Yeah. You just got it.
It's
going
a beautiful thing.
There you go.
Yeah. Nothing like getting money.
It's for life, isn't it?
It's for life.
There you go. Beautiful.
Yeah. As long as I live. So even if I die, my wife's going to keep me around.
Yeah, that's right. That's a good thing. There's some leverage now. You got some more opposite leverage in the life insurance process.
Yeah, but anyway, the bottom line is, when we started going, I started looking for a job, and I'm going to tell you why I couldn't find a job. Nobody.
Yeah.
I saw myself in a corner. I visualized. I'm going to be a corner office, big corporation, big bucks, six-figure income.
Sure.
Feet on my desk, nice martini. Right.
Just being a football player.
Yeah, just being important.
Yeah.
Nobody gave me a job. The job, I got $20,000. $20,000, God, now it's hard to live on $20,000. That is hard. So I got depressed.
Even then?
I started drinking heavy. I started going the wrong way. Woe was me. I was, by the way, when I left Detroit, I was about 288, 290.
Yeah, just under 300
I started
pounds,
getting ready to 300 pounds. So all this was going on, and I was starting to feel sorry for myself. And thank God for friends around me. They helped me get my head screwed on right.
Good.
I got to tell you, everybody out there, every once in a while, you need a kick in the pants.
Mm-hmm.
Get yourself straightened out.
Yeah.
And you need to embrace that if somebody close to you stops you and cares enough about to tell you that.
Yeah. It's because it's hard to do, man. People have the guts to do it. Yeah. There's a reason for it, for sure.
And so with the help of my friends, I started improving myself because something's really scary, Don, because a lot of people don't know where to start improving their life.
Got it.
Everybody in this country thinks it's as good as it gets. The other half want to be better, but don't know how to do it. I started with myself. I went on a lifestyle or a diet, as people refer to it. Yep. I call it lifestyle changes. Lost 65 pounds. And even today, I am actually literally 2 to 5 pounds off my high school weight of 228.
Awesome. That's great.
I'm about 230 now. This is natural, this size of my head.
I get it. Me too.
It's just like we're blessed with more brains.
That's right. I mean, there's only so many, so much space people typically have. We have extra. We both have extra. That's
but,
good.
But you start thinking about things and you start going and I start feeling good.
Yeah.
And before you know, people were asking me, what are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? And the next thing I said, I told them what I was doing and I gave them a number of help, the person who gave me the things that helped me.
Sure.
And then one day she called me up and she says, I want to thank you for the $10,000 I've earned in referrals from you.
Wow.
And I'm thinking, $10,000? I'm making $20,000
a year. Yeah.
And I just referred you that in 3 months?
Yeah.
Woo! I said, what do you do? And that's how I got engaged in the weight loss industry.
Right. And running your own business, entrepreneur.
Yeah.
And obviously since then you've been really successful.
Been in business ever since,
Really successful. You built networks of people up into the...
thousands.
Yeah.
I remember the first 18 months of going into the weight loss industry, earned well over $1 million, $1.2 million in the first 18
That's
months.
Amazing, yeah.
But it did...
Probably more than you did in your whole NFL career, probably, right?
Totally.
Yeah.
Totally.
It's amazing, right?
I said, life is good at this point.
Absolutely.
The only problem is, within another year and a half, the company went out of business, so it all went away. And,
sure.
and that's when my first big fear was, am I good or am I lucky?
Right.
That was a tough time.
Yeah.
Because
I lost a bunch of weight.
Right.
I was a walking billboard. Now what?
Right. Yeah. Can I do it again?
Right.
And so I went out, did it again with another company, and then I started my own stuff. I started buying franchises. I was
mailboxes,
etc. And then bought in with John Cave at Equipment Supply, aerial platform business, worked with him. He was a great guy. And all of a sudden, life was going good. But there was one thing I forgot. Traditional businesses take money to maintain the overhead.
Sure.
Especially if you have employees.
Yeah.
And that was, I was underestimating the cost of growth.
Got it.
And that's important for anybody considering being a business owner. You've got to, whenever you start a business, the first thing you look at, you might have a great idea. Just look to see if there's a multiplier in there. Because if there's no multiplier, then you always do the work yourself.
Right.
And that's not a good
there's
business.
No leverage.
That's a job. That's just paying for your own job.
It's a self-employed versus a business owner.
That's correct.
But you had this background of in the weight loss business, but all and building networks of people.
Yeah.
So you found yourself back to that. And then that's where you're thriving now. So you not only built one of the largest organizations with your current company, that was where we met, both million-dollar earners in that company.
Absolutely.
But also, you kind of evolved pretty quickly into an executive role.
Not that I wanted it. I want everybody to know this. I, an entrepreneur, did not look to become.
You were tricked.
A friend in need.
Right. I get it.
In need with a great idea that deserved to be successful.
Yeah. Agreed.
He ran into some challenges with the company. I'm very proud of it. MarketAmericaShop.com.
Yeah, me too.
And what evolved was there were times early on that he had to overcome major obstacles, he and his wife Lauren. And Nancy and I had the opportunity, Marty Weissman, the three of us, we had an opportunity to work with him. And before you know it, we offered our assistance. I ended up working, Nancy ended up working. You didn't know this, but Nancy used to be the head of events for the
first five
years.
I had no idea.
Yeah,
I did not know that.
First 5 years, she ran all the events. And I worked for free.
Yeah.
So until JR blessed me, he says, okay, I'm going to pay you now.
There you go. I'll pay you now. I'll give you a little something. They're essentially partners of yours now,
right?
Which
is
pretty incredible.
Yeah,
no. And the future is bright for sure with that, and I appreciate it. But then comes you're an entrepreneur. You're successful. You're an executive. You have a really successful business. But obviously something happened. What caused you, and obviously you and Vince have been friends for a long time.
Right.
And you have a gift for people, and I you know that, but I want you to really know that, to connect with people. And I think what's really powerful about you and the gift that you provide is you have a comfort, and I think you almost enjoy it too much to put people on a spot. I really, really do. I watch him like, oh, he just is loving this, you know. But it makes people so much stronger.
Right.
And I think that's why you love it so much. I don't think it's the uncomfortable part. But man, it's amazing, and you have a gift to do that. So you speak now, and you have a lot of, you've been on many different podcasts.
Yeah,
and
television shows, yeah. I mean, radio shows.
And now, so you and Vince kind of collaborated. You mm-hmm. guys have a lot to offer. And you guys have, by the way, a picture in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
In the NFL Hall of Fame.
In Canton, Ohio,
Called The Last Laugh. Uh-huh. Tell everybody about that picture, by the way. How did that, you know, what was that after? I love this story.
That was a great moment in our lives. Vince and I, we made the Philadelphia Eagles. We weren't the superstars, but we were, quote unquote, good enough, but character players.
Got it.
And we're playing the Washington Redskins, where we were just starting to make the turns, and they were undefeated, and we, I think, won one game, and that's it.
Right.
And it came down to some of the last plays, and it came down to a punt. I snapped the ball. Vince broke from the outside. If you saw the movie Invincible, mm-hmm. He makes a big hit, picks up the ball, and runs in for a score. That wasn't the game, but that was the concept.
Yeah.
So he ran down. We snapped the ball. We punted the ball. He ran down, made the hit, and I was able to recover the fumble.
Got it.
We won the game.
Yeah.
Okay. And what happened was we won the game. We were walking off the field. And we were sort of, holding one another like in celebration.
Right.
And right behind us was a scoreboard mm-hmm. saying Philadelphia winning,
right.
you know. And we threw our heads back, and they got a picture. Next day, it's in all the newspapers.
And you guys are laughing.
We were laughing. Yeah. Having a good time. Next thing you know, it's a picture of the year, and it's hanging in the Hall of Fame.
That's amazing.
Which is like, wow.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
It's super, super cool. Which leads me to this, and which is such a great book, by the way. And I want to talk about this real quick. It's called The Last Laugh.
Mm-hmm.
Vision to Victory. And, you know, it kind of alludes to, you know, not only both of your football careers, but all the kind of struggles and some codes that you learned through the process. And I absolutely love it. So tell us about why you and Vince decided to do this. What kind of inspired you guys to co-author a book?
Well, we got together after 40 years of friendships, and we were just having some health drinks made of barley and hops.
Got it. I get it.
and we were talking about, look at us. Why did we do this?
Mm-hmm.
Not only did we make the Eagles, but you had a movie. Mm-hmm. You travel the world and speak to thousands of people. You're now part owner of a billion-dollar company. You travel the world. You speak to thousands of people.
Yeah.
So why does that happen?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it comes to the Victor's Code. And we put together these seven fundamental things that people need to have if they're going to win, to become champions in life, have their success story. We like to call it your last laugh. But, you know, you have many last laughs in your life.
Sure.
But we just start talking. And you know how we started doing this book? We did 32 videos of us talking.
I think that's brilliant.
And we
I did hear that the other day, and I was like,
right.
Oh, that's genius, yeah.
We started with 32 three-minute videos
right.
of topics. And we were able to start taking some notes from it, building a high level of what was in the book. And we had an amazing writer help us out. Bonnie Church was an amazing woman and a successful entrepreneur herself.
Yeah.
But she had a tough time writing for two men. I got to tell you, a woman writing for two men, we abuse her. But her breakthrough was, I got to tell you, mm-hmm. Vince and I took her out of a football game, took her out, got a good tailgate before she knew it, she was talking just like the guy.
She got it figured out quick. There you go. It's just a little experience, you know.
Right.
Maybe a Geno's afterwards.
That's right, yeah. Right. So we got in there, and I'll tell you, it's things like vision. So many people, folks, if you don't understand where you're going, you can have a dream, but if you don't see yourself within that dream. And for instance, it's resulted in thousands of people getting back to us and saying, thank you for helping me define our vision. And at DennisFranks.com, you can download a free vision statement workbook that helps you, goes with the book itself. But then it goes into other things. It goes into the valor, the courage that it needs to get started. Now, these are fundamental principles that are not going to be outlasted ever.
No.
Cross generations.
No matter what happens technologically,
right.
No matter what happens, there's certain things that are core principles. And that's what I love about the book. It's so good.
Absolutely. And, I start thinking about it. You start thinking about vehemence.
One of my favorites, by the way. by the way.
Passionate. You're crazy passionate about what you do. I love you for that.
I appreciate that. I mean, it's what it's all, I mean, what? Why do it if you're not excited or passionate about it, right?
Yeah, and then veracity. And a lot of people don't understand the importance of integrity and telling the truth in what you represent. Mm-hmm.
You just want to be a fast-talking salesman that's just trying to win, you know, get something, and you have to get it.
Yeah, and we break down all of these different things.
I love the honesty and integrity behind it, where in every section of the book, when you're talking about these things, you also qualify those things, which I love. It's because you rarely see that today in any book where it's like, by the way, if you feel like this, realize this is the opposite of what we're saying that maybe you can kind of address in your life.
Right.
That's rare. You never see that. Yeah. So I really appreciate it.
I'll give you a great example. Like under Valor, we have something called fire stoking rituals. Mm-hmm. And every time you do something and what
deal.
You do, you have to get your head right. The mindset is critical in getting the outcome that you want. So a lot of people don't have fire stoking rituals. You know, what are those? You know, hey, it could be anything. You know, when I played football, it was the way you taped your ankles and wrists, your fingers, get ready for the game, you walk the field. Even before we talk and teach and train and go with a big account, you're seeing yourself, the outcome before it's happening.
Yeah.
You're reassuring yourself, your preparation
is
right.
Projections to yourself, yeah.
Yes, and
how you wake up in the morning is another critically important one I think people overlook. Like, do you start your day on offense or defense? You know, how do you, you know, what do you do? So what do you do? What's your ritual? What's your morning ritual, by the way?
My morning ritual.
I asked you this a couple months ago, and I've been so, I mean, that's part of the reason why. Yeah.
It really changes your life. Yeah. My ritual is very simple. I'm going to do 5 to 6 times a week. I'll get up every day at 7 o'clock. That's just my time. I get up, I take my supplement drink, get myself organized, and I go right to the gym or I go right to a bike, you know, touring, or I'll do something that's going to get my heart rate up. I'm going to do that. Then I'm going to come back. I'm going to enjoy some time with my spouse, and we'll sit there, have a nice breakfast, and get ready to start the day. But every day, it's what we do. And it's a great way because it really allows you. I don't bring my phone. And, you know, this is another thing. You got to limit your distractions.
Yeah.
I don't bring my phone. There has to be that me time.
Yeah.
And
so you almost do you combine that with bringing your thoughts together too, almost
it's a time to organize yourself for the day, get your head
gratitude work.
The other thing it helps you do is identify the big rocks. You know, a lot of people like starting the day easy, get the little things out of the way, but it eats up your day.
Damn right.
And you got to start the day by getting uncomfortable. We say jump into the fire. We say you got to start the day by jumping into the fire. Take on that hardest thing each day, you know, right in the morning when you're freshest. Get it behind you and the day is successful.
Yeah. Knock out something that's a big win, and then you have momentum for the day too. Yeah.
Absolutely. Then you.
And I think that's important. Why it's important too that you take that time for the workout before you do that, because now some of those things you have to be on defense to handle.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? And then, but being on offense where you're doing something to progress you forward, whether it be gratitude, whether it be exercise, or all the same.
Right.
Some people, you know, just like sit for 5 minutes and just empty their mind.
Yeah. You brought up something that when we do our next edition of the book, we're going to talk more about, and that is playing an offensive or defensive game in business.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to remind everybody, you may hear the term, you know, they weren't on offense enough, he's playing a defensive game, he doesn't want to lose.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a certain amount of each that happens. There's a word called empathy, that if you're ever going to be successful in business, you're going to have to hear what the challenges are of people.
Yeah.
You don't have to agree with them, but you have to be willing to listen enough to know that what they're saying is important, but you have to prepare to go on offense to counter that and make sure they understand why it shouldn't be that block.
Agreed.
Okay. So again, that's that offense and defense of the day, back and forth. I'd like to say we give ground between the 20s, but come the 20-yard line. Red zone, we are on offense. We are going after it.
Yeah.
You know?
It's so amazing too. And I actually just did a podcast, it was like 2 weeks ago, just a solo run that I did. And I talked about that and I said, you know, are you on offense or defense? Now, you have to have some of both. But in any sport, no matter how good a defense is, if you're always on defense, you get worn out. And you can't win if you're always on defense. You have to have offense at the exact same time.
There's one more thing about the book that I think you'll really like, and that is we thought we were right, but we didn't know. So we went out and got the Victor's Code Hall of Fame. We got 12 very special people, women and men, the likes of Mariel Hemingway, Heather Mitz, Helly Lee. Who are these? Mariel is the actress. Mm-hmm. Heather Mitz is an Olympian soccer player. Helly Lee is a great author. She is amazing. We got movie directors. We've got two billionaires commenting. Coach Harbaugh from the University of Michigan, Dick Vermeil, Super Bowl winning coach. Bo Eason, by the way, Bo Eason played defensive back for the Houston Oilers.
Yeah.
Got hurt, went to Broadway, and made it after 20 years. In fact, he was made famous for the Broadway play called The Runt, in which he starred in, and now they're doing a movie on it. You know, some great things, but they talk about how the code affected them in their life. And it really validates that these things that we brought up are real.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. I mean, when I went through that, it just spoke to me. Every single, you know, component of the Victor's Code just spoke to me. And the way it was explained was just in that, just a little different way than ever before. Mm-hmm. And it makes it sink that much deeper.
Absolutely.
So beautiful. Well, again, so where can people get this? Obviously, DennisFranks.com.
Right, but shop.com. Yep. Just search Last Laugh. Yep. And you'll come up.
Yep.
Also, Amazon.com. Mm-hmm. Many of the bookstores have it right now.
Barnes and Noble,
mm-hmm. You bet. Yeah. I like shop.com.
Great. Yeah, I think I like that one too.
Yeah, I do too.
That's what I do.
Just put in search engine Last Laugh, you're on your way.
That's right. Well, Dennis, listen, I really appreciate this. This was awesome. And mad respect. And looking forward to, you know, just a lot more continued success. You know, watching you in your personal, you know, endeavors, but also some stuff together too.
Thank you.
You know, that we have
I will look forward. Yeah, we do. We got a lot to do. A lot of people that are thinking about being entrepreneurs, and we're here to help you.
That's what it's all about.
Yeah.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you.
Appreciate it, man.
Okay.
You got it.
We'll see you.
You got it.